the harsh reality of being born with an intellectual disability is total social isolation. One of the biggest problems that's faced by people with intellectual disabilities is that their lives are filled with people who are paid to be with them. There are people who are in their lives who are friendly, there are people in their lives who are professional, but those people will only be there as long as they're paid. And as soon as they're no longer paid, they're no longer in their lives. The most important thing that a person with a disability needs, more than anything else, is to be chosen as a friend.
Hello?
Mark Miller.
Yeah?
This is Brian Arbeiter.
Hey, Brian.
How are you?
Good.
Hey, I wanted to call and wish you a happy birthday.
Thank you, Rat Brian.
What are you going to do today?
I don't know. Oh, I'm getting ready for work right now. Yeah, that sounds good.
All right, my friend. Well, have a great day and happy birthday.
Thank you.
Okay.
Bye.
This program raises questions. This program is for people who find it hard to trust God. The best answers are wrapped in flesh and blood. My friends, people who are enduring real tragedies every single day. Quadriplegia, muscular dystrophy, stroke, bankruptcy, loneliness, singleness. We're going to talk to those very people who have touched my life. Have you ever thought about the way you choose your friends? You probably gravitate to people with whom you have similar likes, dislikes, the same interests. You prefer your friend because the two of you resonate. You're of the same ilk. And right there may be why we have a hard time making friends with people who have intellectual disabilities, because obviously they're different, right?
What might be the things that we would create that would allow social access for, say, adults with intellectual disabilities to the community?
So if I came in here and, I stood too close to somebody, first of all, and that would be a social skill faux pas, to stand too close to somebody. And then I burped, out loud or something like that. And then, in the midst of the person who was doing the presentation talking, I talked real loud to my neighbor. I mean, all of those things are social behaviors that would be sufficient for me to be excluded from the environment. So the question is, how do I change the environment such that maybe those aren't exclusionary offenses? You know what I'm saying?
So, wild man, you doing good? What do you know? What's this about? I support the right to harm bears. I love that. That's pretty sweet.
This is a shirt that you got.
I know. I like it. Yeah. Will I hang out for a minute?
Yeah.
What's going on with your workout machine? Is that thing still working? There's the famous bike.
Yeah.
You still working on it? When was the last time you worked out with that bad boy?
I worked out like this morning.
This morning you were working on it?
Another way I could do it.
Okay, let's see it. Like this? Yeah. Oh my gosh. That takes some muscles. You're a big guy lifting up a thing like that. The spokes are okay?
The spokes were loose.
Did they give you heavy-duty spokes or
something? Yeah.
How you doing for food right now? You got your mac and cheese. You like mac and cheese?
And also this. Yeah.
Lean cuisine. You trying to get skinny or something?
Yeah. They're good.
They are good. They are good. I guess you could probably do to lose a couple pounds. I hate to say it.
Yeah, it's true.
Looks like you're not a big banana guy, huh?
I'm eating some, but they get so hot, they just...
They just get brown stuff like that. Do you eat salad and that kind of stuff sometimes?
A little bit.
not too much, but you don't eat salad, but you eat quick.
You're good.
I know, but salad.
You're good.
Salad is better for you. What is this? This looks like some girly thing.
Oh, that was just a thing.
You know, you and I have talked a lot about this before, and you've spoken to people, and I'll ask you sometimes, do you have a disability? If I asked you that question, do you have a disability, how would you answer?
I'm not sure.
Talk to me about some more about that. What do you mean you're not sure?
I don't think I have a disability, because I can ride my bike back and forth to work and to church and do a lot of things. A lot of people that are disability can't do.
All of us are on a scale. We're all on a scale of support needs. And so some of us maybe need less support, and others of us need more support. So rather than taking a score and saying, you have a disability because of that score, a more logical thing to do would be to say, okay, you have these levels of needs that need to be supported. Someone else has these levels of needs that need to be supported. And so all of us end up being on that spectrum of some degree of need.
Wake up. What's going on, man? How you doing?
Good.
Good. Can I come in for a couple minutes? What's going on? You doing good? How's work?
I'm good.
All right.
Doing great.
Hi, Katie.
Been busy last night.
Well, I'm glad you earned your money last night instead of being a slacker. You know what I mean?
I can't afford to be a slacker.
They'll cut you loose. So how many years have you been in this house?
17 and a half years.
17 and a half. Would you say 17 and a half good years?
Good year.
Good
year. Oh, well, maybe when we had those rat, maybe other than the rat problems we had, I'd say, well, probably maybe 13, 14.
Yeah, a couple years of rat problems.
But other than that, it's been good.
I'm glad you got that behind you. Where were the rats? Yes.
We, a couple over here underneath the kitchen sink over here, and a couple in the bathroom, and maybe one or two outside. We had, you know, the rat right there, nothing a little while ago, so as far as we know, we got them all.
Do the dogs catch them at all, or no?
No, they'll
run away.
They'll run the other direction.
Barnwell barked at him.
Yep, it's one big rat trying to catch another rat.
Yeah, exactly. You tell me sometimes that people are unkind to you when you're moving around the community, whether you're riding your bicycle. You remember you've told me about that sometimes?
Yeah.
Why do you think people act like that?
They just don't know me.
They don't know you?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
They don't want to get to take a second stop and get to talk to me, get to know what I'm like. That's what I mean.
What would they learn if they talked to you to find out who you were?
They would get to like me better.
What about you?
I like to make friends with people and talk to people and do things with people.
Mark, did you get another flat tire?
It's not holding my chair.
Okay. I think it's just low. Have you filled it up since the last time you've been here?
No, not lately.
All right, it's probably just low. We got slime and stuff in there, so.
Yeah, probably low.
Let me throw some air in there for you.
Yeah.
I met Mark about 6 years ago. He came into the shop. He had a flat tire. His uncle had pre-called and let him know that, or let us know that he was coming in. After that, we just kind of got his bike all fixed up for him, and it's been happening ever since. Eventually, we just didn't even charge him anymore. His uncle stopped coming in, and we just do it out of donation. We just want him to be happy, and he comes in maybe 2-3 times a week with flat tires or a bent wheel, and we just get stuff replaced for him and just take care of it. You know, he beats the snot out of it, but every time he comes in, he's got something broken. He knows it's broken, and he knows to bring it in, and we got to take care of it for him.
Well, today's my birthday.
Is it birthday?
Yeah.
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
How old are you, Mark?
52.
strong as an ox. I mean, the man's unstoppable, and he's got the motivation to keep himself going, which is good to see.
Are you going to work for your birthday?
Yeah, they need me today.
Going to work on your birthday?
Yeah.
Flat tires, bent wheels, broken cables. Most of the time just flat tires because he doesn't really know to pump up his tires. But, you know, we get him pumped up, and when he gets a pinch flat or something like that, we'll just take care of it.
Hey, Mark. Happy birthday, man.
Happy birthday, Mark. Hey.
When you were born, do you remember your mother and father?
My real mom is somewhere in Mississippi, but...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when was the last time you saw her? It's been a while?
Long time.
Okay. And do you remember your father from when you were a little boy?
No, because he left me before I was born.
Oh. Where do you think your dad went?
I don't know. I don't even know if he's alive anymore. Mm-hmm. I was living with my mom and stepdad, but they didn't work out.
Okay. Why did it not work out with your mom and your stepfather?
Because he was a real nasty person.
He was a nasty person?
Yeah.
What kinds of things would make you say that he was a nasty person?
He was mean, ornery, and he wanted me to learn things I didn't want to learn. Tracy, once my gram heard about that, she was still alive when he was doing all this. She said, forget it, you don't need a stepdad like that. I finally got a chance to learn to live by myself, doing a lot of things like that, meeting up with you and having a good time.
Well, I want to ask you something very personal.
Okay.
You know, the Johnny and Friends ministry is all about ministering to people with various types of disabilities.
Yes.
Are you people who have disabilities? And if so, what is your disability?
I'm just sort of slow.
Yeah, I thought, I'd be really slow myself. I'd be really slow myself, and over the years I improved on that. We had my evaluation, and I got a good evaluation.
Awesome. When you were a kid going to school, did you sometime have bad experiences because people were unkind to you?
Yes, I have. I've had people used to call me names like stupid and words that weren't very nice, and I kind of let it go in one ear and out through the other, and sometimes I would let it really, sometimes it would hit me really hard, but as the years went along, I kind of learned to let it go in one ear and out to the other. Go, hey, what do they know? I know I have a disability. Hey, it doesn't bother me. I just know that the way some kids are.
Mm-hmm.
But hey, that's okay. That's all in the past.
Hey, David, bring me that jug in the bedroom, the one with the money in it. We save all our chips. We have a jug in the bedroom. Actually, we were supposed to go on a cruise, but we didn't get enough, so maybe next year we'll get enough. So if we don't use any of it.
I'm a server. I bus and pre-bus cables, you know, do whatever I can to make myself useful, you know, make me feel right at home there. And would you like another Pepsi or anything, or?
So they got a lot of people here that watch over it. Yeah. And since they put that tire up, it works good.
The more severely disabled that person is, the more time it takes to understand who they are and what their gifts are. So, you know, a real sharp person, you know, hey, interact, what's going on? Hey, I'm doing this, whatever, like that. The more severely disabled a person is, the more time it takes to develop that relationship and find out who they are, which goes against the way that society wants to interact with people, because I gotta take my time. I think a lot of it comes down to what the purpose of life is. If the purpose of life is achievement, then people with intellectual disabilities are just gonna be in the way. If the purpose of life is something else, then they are achievers, potentially.
A few people come out and gather around, as many as you can. Toby is going to open us in prayer.
Hey, Mark, where you going, man?
At my church, we have this group of folks, and we meet every Sunday. We're called the Light and Power Company. It's a ministry that includes adults with disabilities, and we've been going for 20 years now.
All right, here we go. Let's fire it up. What book of the Bible are we in?
First Peter.
Who is Peter? Who is he? Who is Peter? He's one of the disciples? Was he? Okay.
There's a passage in 1 Corinthians 12:21 where Paul says the parts of the body that seem weaker are indispensable. When I think about people with disabilities, they seem weaker to me, but Paul says they're indispensable. Why would they be indispensable? The greatest commandment, the Bible says, is to love God and to love your neighbor as yourself. I find that people with intellectual disabilities are way better at loving their neighbor as themselves than I am and then the average person in society is. So you got to start asking the question, particularly from a Christian perspective, who's got this life right? You know, is it those of us who are achievement-oriented, or is it those who are truly loving their neighbor the way that the Scripture would command us to? Almost every Christian denomination in the world is excluding people with disabilities. To me, that's a foundational problem, because we're basically developing people within Christian churches who do not feel the need to love their neighbor. What could be more basic? People will often say when they come to Light and Power Company, this is the way the church should be, because there's total acceptance, loving, friendship, kindness, inclusion, everything that you wish the church would be. The worst thing that could happen to Mark, I think, is something that he told me. He has told me this several times. He goes, Jeff, I had this nightmare the other night. It was horrible. I said, oh man, what happened? He goes, I dreamt that they didn't want me in the church anymore. And I said, oh man, you know that's not true. Yeah, I know it's not true, but it was a scary dream. I said, well, I bet it was a scary dream. That's the thing from Mark's perspective.
Almost like the Walton's truck.
Like the Walton's had the truck like this?
I think it was something similar to it, but low thing.
What, the Walton show?
Yeah.
Was that in the 60s? I always thought it was so funny. Good night, John Boy. You know that?
Yeah, that was funny. I laughed.
Everybody saying good night, John Boy. Those dogs, I almost hit those dogs a couple of times. They don't get out.
The fact that friendship is potentially the most important thing to an individual with an intellectual disability flies totally in the face of all these things about purpose and life and all this stuff about achievement and everything in the secular and Christian world. But I think the people with intellectual disabilities have got it right. The most important thing in life is friendship.
It's been a bit of a while. Remember you popped a wheelie that time?
Yeah.
I think you thought you were in the
Indiana.
I don't know where you thought you were. But...
I thought I was in the Indiana 500.
I'd never seen this thing do a wheelie before. It's like downtown. Down. Is it pushed down? Let's turn this way a little bit. Okay. That's second. Well, let's just try second here.
Oh,
hold on. Okay. You ready? Okay, now you want to turn right. Okay, turn right down the driveway. It's up now. Turn down the driveway. Turn down the driveway. Turn. There you go. Straighten her out. Straighten her out. You're good. Straighten her out. Keep going. You're good. Let it up. Okay, leave your foot off that clutch now. Just leave it off. Leave it off. Okay, watch where you're going. I'm a good friend to have. The main reason I'm a good friend to have is because I have a car. And so if you have a friend with a car, your life is opened up. If you have a friend with a little money, your life is totally opened up. So I think there's a degree to which when people with disabilities get involved in a church, they get to have friendships with people who have the ability to broaden their kind of horizons of the things that they're able to do because of just what they bring to the friendship. So Friday night,
prom
baby.
Night.
Friday night's prom the big prom night. You got a date?
Amy Clem.
She said she'd go with you.
Yeah.
That's awesome. That's awesome. You guys will have a good time.
Really, I asked her.
Why Amy?
Why Amy?
Yeah, why'd you pick Amy?
Because I figured she'd be the only one that probably want to go with me.
I don't think that's true.
No, but because she's nice.
That's a great reason. Yeah, she is a really nice gal.
Yeah. She don't got that anger situation.
Stuff like that. Yeah, I think she just likes having a good time. Come here, Mark, you feed
them. Come here, Hoss.
You go, here's some more here.
Ooh. Bye-bye, carrot. The best thing I thought about carrot when she was around.
That's any relationship, you know. I mean, that's why you date somebody. You know, you hang out a little while, you go do things, and find out if you're compatible. If you're compatible, then you know, you keep hanging out. If you're not compatible, then you know, then you find somebody else.
You know, that was funny though. At church that one time, she came running up to me. Oh. I love you.
Oh, that's funny.
Mm-hmm. It made me feel good when somebody did that.
Well.
Because nobody else would have done that. I see. She doesn't understand relationships.
Somewhat,
yeah. Sometimes women are hard to understand.
Sometimes they are. I mean, yeah.
Is Kathy really easy to understand?
Oh. Well, I mean, we've been married for 34 years, so I probably ought to understand her somewhat by now.
And let me see.
Let's see.
That didn't look very good, huh? Did that look alright?
Look better than the orange.
There you go. Alrighty. Kathy?
Huh?
Can you get my jacket?
There you go. Yeah, that'll look good.
Alrighty.
Ooh, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. No doubt. I probably should have buttoned up my sleeves first before I put the jacket on.
Oh, that's okay.
Probably would have made more sense.
Come here. You look nice.
Thank you.
You said you had a... Let me see, what shirts do you have? You had maybe a couple shirts. One maybe will go with this tie. I don't know if that works with that.
Hey! I'm Goofy Rod, but I'm just having a good old time.
All right. It looks like Amy's in the back seat, not the front seat.
Yeah.
Wow! Look at you, Amy. You're gorgeous.
Hi.
How
hi.
Are
you? Good.
Hi,
I tried
Jeff.
The first
nice
building
you.
Down there instead of this one.
Jeff came and helped me, and I'm ready.
Yep, you look really, really good.
Thank you.
Looks like you got a haircut.
Yeah.
Got yourself all spiffed up.
Yep, I did.
That's awesome.
I'm looking forward to it tonight.
You and I.
They take pictures of people.
Yeah.
And so I was hoping that you guys would have a nice picture for Amy's scrapbook.
Yeah.
Maybe 5-6 years ago, people got the idea of having like a prom, which would be like a fancy evening out where individuals with disabilities could go out. And it's turned into this beautiful thing. It's almost like a movement across the country where all around the country right now, at prom season, high school prom season, that there'll be proms that'll include adults with disabilities at local churches. And the thing that's amazing about this is, in particular, are the high school kids. The high school kids just step up. So you got these cute little gals dancing with these disabled men and these handsome young guys, you know, moving gals in wheelchairs around. It's just a delightful, delightful night. I wish it was always like this.
Didn't you just love meeting these guys? Mark, David, Jeff McNair, and all of them best of buddies. Were you surprised by that? Sometimes we look at people with disabilities and we see the need, and before you know it, they become our project. We don't perceive them as people with whom we might have an actual give-and-take friendship. No, it's all a one-way missions focus. But God is not impressed with that. He thinks too much of people to consider them projects who need to be worked on or fixed. God's interested in relationships. And when it comes to people we like to hang out with, Jesus, in Luke chapter 14, asks us to think outside the box. Connect with the poor, the lame, the disabled. Someone like David or Mark lives in your community. Seek them out, invite them to church, and then out to lunch. Do this, and you will be blessed. Johnny and Friends depends on the prayers and support of folks just like you. So please, would you help us? Participate with us, pray with us, and give us your gifts. I will be so bold as to ask, because God not only loves a cheerful giver, He loves a cheerful asker. And I am asking you to participate with us, to promote the gospel, push back the darkness, advance the kingdom of Christ, and make a difference for the Lord in the lives of millions of disabled people around the world. Please call our 800 number or donate online at our website at johnnyandfriendstv.org. God bless you as you do.
This program was made possible by the generous support of our friends at Regency Lighting, Chatsworth, California. This episode of Johnny and Friends is available on DVD for $9.95 at johnnyandfriendstv.org. Join us again next week for Johnny and Friends.